Hari Om friends, welcome once again to my Sanatan Duniya channel, your spiritual home. In this video, I shall be giving my commentary upon verses 37 to 47 of the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. For those of you who have not yet watched the commentaries on the previous verses of the Gita, I suggest you go ahead and watch these videos before proceeding further with this video. These videos are available in the playlist titled Bhagavad Gita Commentary, all 18 chapters. Before I go ahead and give the commentary upon these verses of the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, I have a small request to make. If you have not already subscribed to my channel, then I suggest you do so, so that you may be updated about forthcoming videos uploaded to this channel. So let's move on. The 37 to 39 slokas of the 6th chapter of the Gita are as follows. Arjuna said, "What is the destination of the man of faith who does not persevere, who in the beginning takes to the process of self-realization, but who later desists due to worldly mindedness and thus does not attain perfection in mysticism? O mighty Am Krishna, does not such a man, being deviated from the path of transcendence, perish like a riven cloud with no position in any sphere? This is my doubt, O Krishna, and I ask you to dispel it completely. But for yourself, no one is to be found who can destroy this doubt." The commentary of the mentioned three slokas is as follows. In order for a yogi to attain complete freedom from the cycle of birth and death, he needs to first attain samadhi and then repeatedly experience samadhi till the experience of samadhi becomes a permanent state for the yogi. This requires a lot of practice of meditation, usually spanning several lifetimes. The yogi starts with concentration and then his concentration becomes deeper and transforms itself into meditation. When the meditation is perfected over a long period of time with a lot of detachment, the yogi then finally manages to attain the state of samadhi. Since this is a long process and usually takes a very long period of time to perfect, Arjuna gets a valid doubt here in his mind. Arjuna wants to know from the Lord as to what would happen to that yogi who starts the practice of meditation with faith but fails to attain the state of samadhi. Or what would happen to that yogi who starts the practice of meditation with enthusiasm but later finds that attaining the lofty state of samadhi is not his cup of tea. In the past, there have been many yogis who start the process of self-realization with enthusiasm but who later give up the practice for some reason or the other. Some realize that samadhi is too difficult for them. Some get other worldly thoughts and distractions. Some give up due to lack of patience. And some others just lose the motivation or courage to continue. So Arjuna gets this feeling that such a yogi perishes as he does not manage to attain the goal of self-realization, and also since he committed himself to yoga, he does not enjoy material success which he could have otherwise pursued. Hence Arjuna is asking the Lord to clarify this doubt of his. Now I shall move on to verses 40 to 45. The 40th to 45th verses of the 6th chapter of the Gita are as follows. The Blessed Lord said, "Son of Partha, a transcendentalist engaged in auspicious activities does not meet with destruction either in this world or in the spiritual world. One who does good, my friend, is never overcome by evil." The unsuccessful yogi, after many years of enjoyment on the planets of the pious living entities, is born into a family of righteous people or into a family of rich aristocracy. Or he takes his birth in a family of transcendentalists who are surely great in wisdom. Verily, such a birth is rare in this world. On taking such a birth, he again revives the divine consciousness of his previous life and he tries to make further progress in order to achieve complete success, O son of Guru. By virtue of the divine consciousness of his previous life, he automatically becomes attracted to the yogic principles even without seeking them. Such an inquisitive transcendentalist striving for yoga stands always above the ritualistic principles of the scriptures. But when the yogi engages himself with sincere endeavor in making further progress, being washed of all contaminations, then ultimately after many births of practice, he attains the supreme goal. The commentary of the mentioned six slokas is as follows. In the previous set of three verses, we saw Arjuna asking the Lord as to what would happen to the unsuccessful yogi who initially takes to the practice of meditation with faith but later desists due to some reason or the other. What would be the fate of such a yogi? The Lord replies in the affirmative by saying that one who does good is never overcome by evil either in this world or in the spiritual world. When a yogi takes to the practice of meditation but is unable to attain samadhi before death and hence unable to experience godhood prior to death, he then proceeds to the heavenly spheres where the pious dwell. After many years of enjoyment in the higher spheres, he returns to this material realm when his merit is exhausted. What happens is that the mind remains the same in different incarnations. In his previous incarnation, the yogi took to the process of self-realization with determination. This impression or samskara of determination continues to remain in the yogi's subtle body even after the death of the physical body. He then proceeds to heaven where he enjoys the fruits of his good karma. After this, he returns to the earth along with the samskara of determination and love for the spiritual path in his mind. In his next incarnation, Bhagwan gives him the conditions which would be favorable for the pursuit of spiritual search. The yogi is perhaps born in a family which has no shortage of wealth, but rather an abundance of wealth. This being the case, the yogi does not have to struggle for survival and prosperity, but rather has to only concentrate on his spiritual search. Or, Bhagwan might give him even more favorable conditions in his next life, in the form of a birth in a family of enlightened yogis. Being born in a family of enlightened yogis, the yogi gets exposed to spiritual matters, discussions and practices from a small age itself. This paves the way for him to continue the spiritual pursuit which he undertook in his previous birth. Hence, one way or the other, the yogi gets conditions favorable for his spiritual pursuit and he is therefore able to progress further on the spiritual path. Many a time we find youngsters getting attracted to the spiritual path very easily and naturally. Without even seeking such a spiritual path, they are attracted to spiritual matters at a young age. They then demonstrate tremendous potential for spiritual matters from a young age and continue their spiritual pursuit until they attain the goal of samadhi. Now Bhagwan is also saying that such spiritual enthusiasm may find fruition in one or two lives or maybe even more number of lives, depending on the spiritual capacity of the yogi apart from other factors. One way or the other, a person who commits himself to the spiritual path never meets with destruction either in this life or the lives to come. He rather gets favorable conditions for continuing his spiritual pursuits until he finally attains the goal of self-realization in a future lifetime. One can therefore safely say that once a yogi, forever a yogi. Now I shall move on to verses 46 and 47. The 46th and 47th verses of the 6th chapter of the Gita are as follows. A yogi is greater than the ascetic, greater than the empiricist, and greater than the fruitive worker. Therefore, O Arjuna, in all circumstances, be a yogi. And of all yogis, he who always abides in me with great faith, worshipping me in transcendental loving service, is most intimately united with me in yoga and is the highest of all. The commentary of the mentioned two slokas is as follows. In the first of these two verses, Bhagwan is saying that a seeker who takes to the path of meditation is superior to the one who takes to the other paths such as Hatha Yoga, Jnana Yoga or Karma Yoga. A Karma Yogi's path is pretty simple. He only needs to perform all his actions without expecting anything in return and without the notion that he is the doer of actions. Also, he needs to dedicate his actions to God. Initially, he may find it difficult to work without considering rewards and fruits of action, but eventually he learns the art of being detached from the end result of all actions. However, this path of Karma Yoga is a slow path and is not a direct path. In this path, the yogi's attention still continues to flow outward, and hence, until the yogi learns to remain calm in the midst of his duties, spiritual realization through Karma Yoga is going to take a very long period of time. Hence, a yogi or a Dhyana Yogi is superior to a Karma Yogi as he takes to the direct path of meditation and turns his attention inwards, unlike the Karma Yogi who continues to turn his attention outwards. The yogi or Dhyana Yogi is also superior to the Jnana Yogi. The Jnana Yogi takes the cumbersome path of contemplation upon the meanings of the different pieces of knowledge which he hears from different sources. The Jnana Yogi, after a period of time on the spiritual path, may develop another kind of vasana called Shastra Vasana, which arises out of studying too much from the scriptures. Also, he might get caught up in his logical mind, and for spiritual realization, one needs to transcend logic and the intellect. However, the Dhyana Yogi or the meditative yogi, on the other hand, does not concern himself much with the theoretical understanding of the scriptures. The Dhyana Yogi too studies the scriptures, but does not go deep into the scriptures and develop Shastra Vasana. After having a basic understanding of the scriptures, he focuses his attention inwards and hence proceeds straight to the exact place where the knowledge is to be found, which is within his soul. Spiritual realization can be had only by going within oneself during meditation and not by studying too many scriptures. Bhagwan is also saying here that the yogi is greater than the ascetics. The ascetics take to the path of Hatha Yoga. They perform all sorts of physical postures and disciplines which are complicated and are also not the direct route to God. As I already said, spiritual realization can be had only by going inward, which is rightly done by the Dhyana Yogi or Yogi. The ascetic gets so preoccupied with his postures that he hardly makes contact with the self within him, which is where he can find God. Hence, we can understand from this discussion that the path of Dhyana Yoga or meditation is superior to all other paths, as it is a direct path where all of one's attention is directed inwardly and directly to the place where one can find and know the truth. In all the other paths, the attention is directed outwards and not inwards. Hence, these paths are indirect or inferior paths. These paths shall also take a longer time to produce the effect of self-knowledge or self-realization. However, the path of Dhyana Yoga or meditation is a direct path, as the attention is from the beginning directed inward, which is where truth can be experienced directly. Hence, one can safely say that meditation is the highway leading to the truth, and that the other paths are bypaths to the same destination. Further, in the next verse, Bhagwan is adding a cherry to the Dhyana Yogi's cake by saying that of all the Dhyana Yogis, the one who has utmost faith in Bhagwan and renders loving service to Bhagwan is the best of all. Yogis who want to attain siddhis and name and fame and money for themselves are also yogis, but they are not devoted to God or truth. They want something for themselves and they don't truly love Bhagwan and do not do their meditation in order to love and please Bhagwan. However, the yogi who practices meditation upon the self out of love for Bhagwan and with no other ulterior or selfish motive is the true yogi in Bhagwan's opinion. So friends, here ends the commentary on the 37th to 47th verses of the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. And with this, we come to the end of the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Stay tuned for more commentaries on the following verses of the Gita and keep checking this channel for updates to this playlist titled Bhagavad Gita Commentary All 18 Chapters. And also do watch the other videos available in this channel so that you can enhance your knowledge of the eternal religion or Sanatan Dharma. And in case you have not already subscribed to my channel, then I suggest you do so, so that you may be updated about forthcoming videos uploaded to this channel. Thank you very much for watching. Have a great time ahead. Hari Om.